Oh, fill my cup, Lord. I lift it up, Lord. Come and feel this thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Fill my cup, fill it up, and make me whole. I thought about that song just before came on with you this morning. It's a beautiful Sunday morning. God bless you. Thank you for joining me. And that's an old song we used to always sing, Fill My Cup, Lord. But the question for me and for you today is, are we always in that place of fill my cup, Lord? Are we always in a place of we need another miracle? Are we walking in that way, one miracle for another, or are we walking in the provision of the Lord? And there's nothing wrong with that song and nothing wrong with that prayer, but perhaps we could look at it in a little different way. Here on the heels, blessings, Pastor Steve. Good to see you with me. Here on the heels of the greatest gift ever given to mankind, the gift of our Savior, born in a Virgin Mary, the Christ child. A lot of gift giving, I'm sure, throughout the last last couple of days. So here we are on a Sunday morning, and I'm thinking too of the gift. So let me bring this on screen so you can see what the Lord really kind of laid on my heart, and that is the supplying or depleting. Are you in a position, or am I in a position of mostly supplying, or am I one that's doing the depleting? You know, here we are at the very end of the year, and I'll bring up a couple of things on the screen because I just want you to see what's going on here. Let's see. That's not the one, and that's not the one. There's one more that I'm missing. There we are. That's what I want to do. Thanks again for joining me. And can I encourage you to do this? Pastor Steve's on here. Pastor Jimmy's on here. You know, the greatest and easiest way to get the word these days shared is by way of sharing. You know, you look at the apostles, and Lori brought this to my attention, how quickly they evangelized, how quickly the church grew because they were spreading the good news. And so my question to you is, are you just receiving, or are you giving back? Are you only receiving and not sharing and giving out? Because in this day and time, it's really easy to share. And for example, I have that up there on the top left-hand screen, please share. It's as simple as clicking on, if a message from Pastor Steve, Pastor Jimmy, if it blesses you, don't you think it'll probably bless somebody else? And you have different friends than I have. We have some of the same friends, but we don't have an identical friend list here on Facebook. So would you just, after you watch this message today, after you listen in on Pastor Steve, Pastor Jimmy, someone else, just share it. That's how we get the word out. That's how we get the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ out. I'm not trying to promote me or them, but I am absolutely promoting God's word. So let's get into the scripture, and let me tell you how this came about. I had recently someone mention the Great Commission. We know that at the end of Matthew 28, and we know what it talks about going into all the world. Go ye into all the world and make disciples is actually what we're supposed to be doing. That's not just for the pastors. That's not just for the shepherds. In fact, if you think about it, sheep beget sheep. You know, sheep reproduce sheep. And so here's the deal. We all are evangelists, and that's a word that we're going to find in our passage today in Ephesians, the fourth chapter. That word really, evangelist, is I only see it around three different times. It doesn't mean it's less important, but I want to say that when you look at a fivefold ministry that we're going to just kind of skim through to get us to the meat of what I believe God wants me to share with you today, and that is being an encourager or a discourager. here we have Jesus still giving gifts, and that's what Ephesians 4 talks about. So let me just get it on the screen for you and show it to you here. Ephesians, the fourth chapter. Some of the verses we're going to miss or skip over. We don't have time to get into all of them. But Paul starts out with, "I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord." And you know that if there's a therefore, there's therefore a reason. And what you would need to do is read chapters 1 through 3 of Ephesians and see that he's sharing about the wonderful grace that has been given to you and me, the grace that has been provided. Therefore, that's why he says, "I therefore," chapter 4, "I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy," that you walk worthy. Now, that's interesting because as you look up that word and you look up the original meaning, it has a reference to like a scale. You remember the scales that they would, you know, teeter-totter, and you'd put the weight on one, and whatever's the most value would outweigh the other one, and that would shift up. Well, I believe what the Apostle Paul is telling us is that when you put on the scale of our belief, that's why I put we behave based on how we believe. If our belief system is based on the true word of God and the grace given to us, we are going to walk worthy. In other words, we're going to act like what we say we believe. We are going to prove by our works our faith in Jesus Christ. So there's going to be a change, y'all. There's going to be a change in the way we behave. And so that's what he's saying. He said, "I, a prisoner of the Lord Jesus Christ, of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation, of the calling." Makes me think of Romans 8. Romans 8. I love Romans 8. Somebody said it to me the other day. A pastor, in fact, had a funeral at our church, and he mentioned a verse, and I said, "Man, I love Romans 8. And just to get you back there for just a moment, and we'll go back to the scripture, I want to for you to hear what Romans 8 talks about, because he says that you walk worthy of the vocation. In other words, you walk worthy of the calling. You realize we have been called to be sons and daughters of the Most High God. We've been called to be kings and priests. We've been called a chosen generation, a royal priesthood. And in Romans, the 8th chapter, he talks about, we know that all things work together for the good of them who love the Lord. And he says, "For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son." That's what all of this is about, that we, the body of Christ, and that's what Ephesians 4 is talking about, will continue to grow, will continue to mature. We won't always be a taker. We'll also become a giver. In our bodies, there's more. I get off of that, and let me go on with Romans 8, to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Whom he did predestinate, them he also called. He called you, my friend. He called me. And when he called us, that's what Paul's talking about in that worthy, that you be worthy in Ephesians 4. He says, those he called, he also justified, as if nothing ever happened. That's the grace of God. That's the gift of salvation. That's what God did for me. That's what God did for you. That's why Paul is like saying, "Hey, I'm a prisoner of the Lord now. I was a prisoner of the dark side, but now I've come to the light side." Some kind of scientific, doesn't it? And he says, "Them also he justified, whom he justified, them he also glorified." Hallelujah. And then he goes on, "What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, oh, who can be against us?" It's Sunday morning. It's a beautiful day. And we are talking about being an encourager or being a discourager. So let's go back to the Ephesians 4th chapter. And I want to get over here as quickly as I possibly can, if my mouth will keep up with my brain. All right. So he says, "I, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called. With all lowliness," that's humility. That's the opposite of pride. Pride is the very thing that got Satan's rear kicked out of heaven, and it's the very thing that keeps him going and motivated today. Go all the way back to Genesis and see what motivated him. pride. Okay. And he says, walk in lowliness and meekness with long suffering. That's what you got. That's how you got to say that. With long suffering. That's a lot of patience there. Forbearing one another in love. And endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. In the, you know what the bond of peace is? He says it over in, what is it? Peter, he says, or Colossians. Yes, Colossians. Colossians, the third chapter. In the third chapter, he talks about love or charity being the bond of peace. So charity, love, is the glue of peace. So if you're not having peace in your life, it's because the glue is missing. It's the bond of peace. It's the love. The charity is missing in your life or in mine. And so when he's talking about this endeavoring to keep the unity, humility, it's patience toward others. It's bending over backwards to keep the unity of the faith and harmony amongst God's people. I don't know about you, but if you've ever sang harmony with someone, singing a solo is one thing, but getting a duet or a trio or a quartet, all of a sudden everything's changing because how many of you know you can't just sing wherever you want to as the lead singer, well, or any other parts, and expect to harmonize. You've got to mesh and mold with one another. So there's sometimes that you got to go higher when you're used to going lower on a particular phrase, and or vice versa. But that's what we're getting here in Ephesians, the fourth chapter. He's saying bend over backwards, do whatever it takes to keep the unity, the bond of peace. And he goes on and he says there is one body. One body of Christ, irregardless of how many churches we have or congregations or different signs or different brands or different beliefs, there is only truly one body of Christ. He says there's one body and one Spirit. The same Spirit of the Holy Ghost that lives in me lives in you. You don't have a different spirit than I do. If we both are born again and have the Spirit of Almighty God, the Spirit of God living in us. So he says, one God, one body, one Spirit, even as you are called in one hope of your calling. And again, it goes back to that walking worthy of the calling. Now let's go on. He says, one Lord, one faith. Yes, one faith. I know it doesn't seem possible, but this is what the Word of God says. One baptism, and I don't believe that's talking about water baptism. I believe that's talking about the baptism, the Spirit of God that comes upon each one of us when we repent, turn, convert, and become born again. That's what I believe. Now, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all, but into every one of us, and I'm trying to get to this verse 16, to every one of us, that means you, me, every one of us is given grace, and I could spend some time here. Each one of us is given, King James says, the measure of faith. Some other translations say a measure of faith. Irregardless, we all get the measure, a measure of faith. Okay, so he says, but to everyone is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Now there we're getting to some gifts. He's going to be giving gifts according to this Ephesians. He's already done this. He's already given gifts. He gave the greatest gift of all through his birth. And then after his resurrection, After he dies, he's buried, then he goes into the ground and into the lower parts of the earth. Well, let me just read it for you on the scripture. It says, wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. So let's go on. He says, Now that he ascended, what is it but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? I don't have time to spend on Hades and what Christ did, but he went down and he set those captives free, taking them to heaven. So no more do we go, I believe, to Hades when we die as believers. We go to heaven and await the resurrection and redemption of our body. Feel like a preacher this morning, but it's just good stuff. He that descended, okay, and he gave. Here we go. And he gave. Everybody say he gave. He gave. He gave. What did he give? And why did he give what he gave? And all of this is really important, because I want you to understand how that this plays into. Here we are, the end of the year. I don't know if you've taken an assessment of your life and what has transpired this year. That's what I'm doing. That's what we're going to do when we meet together, our congregation at Beams of Light this morning, is to take an assessment of what has transpired. What have I given this year? Not just financially, that, yes. What have I given? What have I given back? What have I been a blessing? Have I been a conduit of blessing? Has God's blessings come to me and I've let them flow through, or had they just come to me and I just held on? Is it back like this? Is it back to supplying or depleting? And we're going to get to that supplying and depleting in just a minute. Am I a supplier? Do I always, in a relationship, those of you who are friends with me, those of you who know me, have known me all your life, am I one that is constantly taking, or am I one that is also giving? I pray that I'm not one of those that are always taking. God help me if I am. God help you if that's where you find yourself in a relationship. And I know sometimes we go through seasons where we need to be the one in the recipient mode, but not all the time. Not all the time should I be the one that is needing to fill my cup, Lord, because it's no longer fill because I got it full of me or something else trying to take your place, God. So let's go back to the scripture and get to the ending. I'm not saying I'm ending, by the way, y'all. I'm just wanting to tell you I'm getting to the ending, okay? So what did he give? Well, according to verse 11, he gave some apostles and some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers, and I happen to believe those are kind of together, but it's okay, doesn't matter, pastors and teachers, anyway, for the perfecting of the saints. Oh, so here we get to the meat of what Paul is saying to the Ephesians and to you and I. These are gifts for purpose. Not for us just to hang on and hold on and say, man, I got mine. You got yours. No, they are all given, the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, pastors, teachers, for the perfecting of the saints, for the growing up, for the maturing of the saints. That's what it's for. When we come together in our congregations, and your pastor teaches, you have evangelistic, you have ministry going on. That's what it's about, is to be growing us up to where we're not constantly being a taker, but we start learning to be a giver. We are not constantly being a discourager and down in the mouth and lower than a snake's belly in a wagon rut type of a person, but we get to a place where we're an encourager too. And all of a sudden, you enjoy seeing me coming instead of enjoying seeing me go. All right, everybody with me? All right, this is a good message that we all need to get to. Started out with a relationship of the commission, go ye into all the world and disciple people. So my question is, what part are you playing? What role are you playing? Are you being an encourager at your church? Are you being a supporter of your pastor? Or you being one of those that are always critical, always judgmental, always pulling them down, always pulling the work of the ministry, always pulling, I don't like that song, I don't like that singer, I don't like the keyboard, I'd rather have a regular piano. I don't like the regular piano, I'd rather have that. I don't like an acoustic, I'd rather have electric. Are anybody following me this morning? Everybody say, praise the Lord, you still love me? All right, here we go. We're going to get to the verse 16, just a few more verses here. So all of these gifts, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers are for the purpose of perfecting, maturing, growing up the saints for the work of the ministry, for the edifying, there we go, the edifying of the body of Christ. If you all will think about your own body, because we are the body of Christ, are we not? Why on earth does he have his body here if I'm not supposed to be? His mouth, his hands, his feet. There's times I'm his mouth, there's times I'm his hands, I'm his body. That's the way he designed it. Not me, not my idea, but God's idea. Through Christ, to have his body on earth. And so as we look at this body, in my own physical body, if I have a part of me that's hurting, I have a knee that enjoys throwing a fit once in a while from my football days here in Sepulpa, junior high and high school, from being double teamed on the strong side tackle where the most of the plays wanted to go through, and all of a sudden all those ligaments torn. If I'm not careful and that knee starts acting up, you know what my entire body does? Caters to it. That's natural. My whole body caters to that. All of a sudden, if you sprung an ankle or something, your whole body works to cater to that ailment. And before long, the rest of your body's, I mean, it's taking a toll on it. How many knows what I'm talking about? Again, thanks for joining me. That's the way the body of Christ works spiritually, supernaturally. It's all the same. So he goes on, he says, this is for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry. Verse 13, and then we'll end with 16. Till we all come in the unity of the faith. Everybody say all. All. That don't mean just a couple of us. That don't just mean my congregation or yours. That means all of the body of Christ come in the unity of the faith. That's a prayer that Jesus prayed, John 17. And if he prayed it, I'm convinced it's going to happen. And so until we come into the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man. There we go again. Go back to Romans 8 and see what it said. What did it say in Romans 8 about that? It said, he said, moreover, whom he did predestinate, then he also called, before that, for whom he did foreknow, I'm reading Romans 8:29, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son. Does that sound like what we're reading here in Ephesians? Till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto a perfect, mature, unified body of Christ, under the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, and that we henceforth, verse 14, be no more children. Everybody say, grow up, Mike. Just say it to me. Grow up, Mike. That's what I need. That's what you need. Grow up. Grow up, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine. Man, there's all kinds of doctrines out there. There's all kinds of false prophets. Matter of fact, go back and read about straight is the way and narrow is. Read where that comes in at. I believe it has to do in the context of that sitting about false prophets. Read right after that verse. I'm not there this morning, but here's where we're at. Ephesians, the fourth chapter, finishing up, verse 14, 15, and 16. That we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness. There's a lot there. Whereby they lie in wait to deceive. But speaking the truth in love, and I hope you get that this morning. I'm speaking, I believe truth from the Word of God. And I hope you are convinced that it's in love. It's not to be harsh and to be hard on anybody, but it is the truth. We do need to be an encourager, not always a discourager. We do need to grow up. We do need to get a hold of the truth for ourselves and realize the gifts that he's been given to us. Speaking the truth in love may grow up into him. in all things, which is the head, even Christ. Let's finish with verse 16. From whom the whole body fitly joined together. Here's where I'm going to get to that supplieth. Okay. Let me bring it one more time back on the screen. Find my mouse. Okay. Here it is. Well, get me off. All right. Supplying or depleting. Here's where I came up with that title. And it's, let me do it here. Let me go back here. And I don't have me on the screen, and that's fine. You don't have to see me. So he says, from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth. Supplieth. So are you being a supplier today, or are you only depleting? According to the effectual working in the measure of every part, maketh increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. Edifying itself in love. Saints, that's what we're supposed to be doing when we gather together. That's what we're supposed to be doing here on what a wonderful platform and avenue to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. So thank you for joining me. Thank you for joining your pastor. Thank you for joining all of those that are sharing God's truth today and any day. And take time to just click on that share button so you can share it with your friends. If any of this has been a blessing to you today, would you just take a moment and click share? Just say, hey, found this interesting. Did you know you can also say at 12 minutes in, that really stuck out to me? How do you know that? Well, you just scrub with that little scrub bar down. You see about where it says, because it'll say 11:36, 12 minutes. I don't know how long I went today, but I just wanted to share some news about a reflection back to this year in my life. Lord, have I been an encourager or a discourager? Have I taken more than I've given? Have I supplied, or have I just been depleting? Lord, I want to be a supplier. No matter how old our body gets in this life before we cross over to glory land, our body still has to work, albeit it may not work quite as good. I mean, I understand that, getting up off the floor is, it's not as easy for me anymore. But all of my body has to work together to make that happen. I'm believing in a prosperous, blessed, favor-filled, miraculous, supernatural manifestation of the glory, the presence of God for this next year coming up. I'm believing the prophets, whether I see the fulfillment in my lifetime or not. I'm trusting in a God that knows all things, a God that cares more than we can even imagine that he cares. And I'm looking forward to what more can I give? What more can I share? How can I do better in encouraging others? How can I do a better job of sharing your gospel, Lord, on this platform and others? Did you know you can catch me on YouTube as well? So if you have people that go, well, I don't do that Facebook thing, okay, tell them, just go to YouTube, type in Mike Harris, and they can see all of these messages on YouTube. If that's too difficult, tell them to go to beamsoflight@sepulpa.com. There's a big black box that says watch videos, and they can click on there. People need the Word of God. Listen to these my other pastor friends that are on here and off. Pastor Jimmy's probably already started and going. He usually goes around 8:30. Pastor Steve is on quite often. So even if you miss him today, you can catch him probably tomorrow or the next day. There's others out there that I highly recommend. And Saints, this is a time, if there ever was a time, to get more of God's word in us, because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. I pray for you that this year coming up, you'll be more of an encourager, more of a supplier than you ever have to the body of Christ. God bless you. Enjoy this Sunday.